we return to the chapter by. There's only one organization, only one ecclesiastical body that Jesus Christ ever founded, and that's the church. Jesus said, I will build my church. It belongs to him. Now, Paul taught us a few Sundays back that the mission of the church is to be the pillar and the ground of the truth. And he said the message of the church is to proclaim the good news, the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And Peter said we are, as a church, in 1 Peter 2, verse 9, a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Pray with me just a moment. Lord, we do thank you for the scriptures this morning. Lord, we thank you for the word of God. We ask you again to open our hearts and minds to understanding, to clarity. Lord, lead us and guide us to the service this morning, and let your word settle into our hearts and our minds. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And I say all of that to you this morning to express to you what a wonderful blessing it is to be a part of the body of Christ, part of the church, part of this church. But there's something we need to understand in regard to the church. In order for a church to be successful, to properly carry forward the message and carry forward the mission of the church, there must be good leadership in the church. God has always put leaders before his people. If you go back to the Old Testament and you look at the nation of Israel, God gave the nation of Israel judges and kings and prophets and priests as leaders within that nation. And their message and their mission really wasn't all that much different than ours. They too were to proclaim the coming of Messiah. They were to stand upon the word of God and proclaim his truth. But they failed. They failed in their mission. They failed in their message. And a lot of the reason why they failed was because their leadership failed. The priests failed. The prophets failed. The kings, the judges, they failed. So God took the mission and the message, and he gave it to another nation. He gave it to a holy nation that we, and Scripture calls the church. And just like God set leaders before the nation of Israel, God sets leaders before his church. And sadly, the same pattern that we saw in the nation of Israel often occurs in churches today because leadership fails. And when leadership fails, the church fails to proclaim the message and fails to carry forward the mission. I truly believe a lot of the reason that many churches fail to do that today is because they don't follow a pattern of biblical eldership. Biblical leadership as it's laid out in the scriptures. So Paul writes to that this morning. This morning Paul's going to give us some information regarding biblical eldership within the church. The biblical pattern for leadership in the church is a pattern of an elder-led church. An elder-led church. Now when I say that, some people cringe. Some people start to kind of get bowed up. They get angry about it. And that's because they think that what I'm talking about is a church that is ruled by the pastor. And I tell you, that's not what I'm talking about this morning, so don't worry. That's not biblical. There's never anything in the Bible that tells us that the church should be ruled by one man. So that's not where we're going. And I understand the church should be a corporate model either. Here in our culture, churches often follow the corporate model. They have a CEO that's oversaw by a board, and then they have associates that work under the CEO. Churches do that. They have a board that oversees the pastor, and the pastor oversees the associate pastors that are working under him, and that's not a biblical model either. And I may make some of you angry this morning, but I see very little evidence of a democratic church in the Bible either. There's some. So don't get me wrong, and believe me, I'm not saying that those churches that do those things are bad churches. I'm not saying that they're poorly led. Many of them are well led. But what I'm saying is I think the Bible has a better way. there's good and there's better, right? And we want to do what's best. And I think Paul lays that out for us this morning. But understand, nowhere in the church, nowhere in the Bible, do I ever see a church that gathers together and has business meeting. Nowhere in the Bible do I ever see people using parliamentary procedure, Robert's rule of order, to make motions and second motions and discuss motions and vote on motions. It's just not there. Not in the Bible. There are times when the church operates under a democratic process. And usually in Scripture, when that happens, it deals with people. Selecting people or dealing with people. There are three places in the New Testament that I find where the church is using a democratic process. And the first one is involving church discipline. Now, we know that Jesus said, if your brother sins, you know, go to him privately. And if that doesn't work, go to him with two or three witnesses. And if that doesn't work, then bring him before the church. And when that happens, then the church has to decide what to do with that sinning member. We're going to put him out or not. So there are times when we use that democratic process in that situation. Another time is the church democratically chooses leaders. The church gets to choose who the elders are, who the deacons are, who the pastor is. So there's a democratic process there that's obvious in Scripture. And then there are other times when the church needs to send someone out for some purpose. Maybe on a mission, maybe to carry a message somewhere or do something, so the church gets to determine by democratic process who they're going to send. Those are the times when I see democracy working within the church. But other than that, what we see within the biblical model here is a model of biblical eldership. Now, some people want to point to the Jerusalem Council. We hear about the Jerusalem Council in the book of Acts. There was an issue with Gentiles that were coming into the church, especially in places off like Antioch. And they didn't know whether or not those people needed to be circumcised or not. Whether or not they needed to follow Jewish traditions and the Old Testament law. So they sent Paul and Silas, Barnabas actually, to Jerusalem to talk to the apostles. To set up a meeting there. And to ask for, what do we do? What's the right thing to do here? Now, some people say, well, the whole church gathered it, and they made that decision. And I tell you, that wasn't the case. Listen to who gathered. In Acts 15, verse 6, the apostles and the elders came to consider the matter. So it wasn't the whole church that gathered. It was the elders and the apostles that gathered together to make this decision. They wrote a letter. They came to a decision. They wrote a letter and said, look, they don't need to be circumcised. They don't have to follow all of those Jewish rules. There are a few things we wanted to do, and they wrote it all out. And then the church came together, and what did they do? They voted. They voted over who they were going to send that letter to the church in Antioch with, who was going to carry the letter. So we see in the biblical pattern that the elders were making a decision, and then the church was deciding who would carry that decision. The church decided people, the elders decided the issue. That's a biblical pattern all through Scripture, all through the New Testament. Unfortunately, over time, many churches have fallen away from that biblical model. The early churches understood that. That's what they did. Peter said in 1 Peter 5, verse 1, the elders who are among you, I exhort. He says, this is what I'm telling you elders to do. I'm exhorting you. What was he was telling them to do in verse 2, the very next verse? He said, shepherd the flock of God, which is among you, serving as overseers. So I'm exhorting you, you elders, oversee the church. Shepherd the church. Feed the church. Take care of the church. Guide the church. That's what shepherds do. So the church should be led by a group of elders, not one. Not one, but a group of elders who are chosen from among the church. These men, they lead the church, they guide the church, they teach the church, and they set a good example for the church to follow. Just about every chapter that we've been through here in the book of 1 Timothy has expressed the fact that there was a problem with leadership in the church in Ephesus where Timothy was currently serving. And now Paul, he's showing the church there and showing churches everywhere how to correct that. How to come back to a restoration of biblical eldership. Now back in chapter 3, which we studied some time ago, Paul laid out qualifications. He says this is what you should expect from a man who is, as he said, a bishop. And we know from our study then that a bishop, a pastor, an overseer, an elder, all of that's the same person, that all comes from the same Greek word, presbyteria, which is just a biblical word, but they're all the same, is what I want you to understand. So as I say elders this morning, understand that's the same person as a pastor or an overseer or a bishop in the church. Paul starts by telling the church there in Ephesus, this is how you treat an elder. This is how you treat an elder. He says in verse 17, let the elders who rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in the word and doctrine. For the scripture says, you shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain, and the laborer is worthy of his wages. So the key word there again is honor. Honor. Honor those elders who do a good job, especially those, he says, who teach the word of God and who keep the church aligned with correct doctrine, who teach sound doctrine in the church. So I understand there's an especially there. What Paul is saying is there are elders in the church who have different roles. Not every elder is the same. Some of the elders who are preaching and teaching, they are especially worthy of honor. There are other elders within the church who lead in a different area, who lead in other areas. Maybe they're gifted in other ways. Not every elder has to be a preacher. Not every elder has to be a pastor. Some handle administrative duties. Some handle church maintenance duties. Some handle this. Some handle that. They lead in other places. Paul says the ones who preach the word and who handle the doctrinal issues, those are especially worthy of honor. 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 12 says, we urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and who are over you in the Lord and admonish you and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. Hebrews 13 verse 7 says, remember those who rule over you, who have spoken the word of God to you, whose faith follow, consider the outcome of their conduct. Paul says, look, remember the man who leads you, remember the man who teach you, remember the man who set a good example for you to follow. Hebrews 13, verse 17 says, obey those who rule over you, and be submissive, for they watch out for your souls as those who must give an account. And so the Bible speaks in plural terms when it comes to elders. Is it S on it? More than one. Each church has multiple elders within the church. Not just one, multiple elders within the church. And each church, scripture says, submits to the elders because the elders have responsibility for the church and God holds them accountable for what's going on in that church. But understand this. The elders are accountable to the church. The elders are always accountable to the church. The church has a responsibility to hold the elders within the church accountable. And Paul expresses that very soon here. But we need to understand elders here, when we say elders, we're referring to the office of elder. This isn't just a group of older men from within the church who are gathering together to talk about things that are going on in the church. That's not what it means when it says elder. These are the people who are the elders, the pastors, the overseers, the bishops of the church. And I want you to understand they're not deacons. Because there's two different offices here. Two different offices. The deacons are the servants of the church. The elders, they're the overseers of the church, the bishops of the church. And the big difference there is only one thing. Only one thing. An elder must be an apt teacher of the Word of God. Really, if you look at the qualifications, they're almost exactly word for word for the same, except for that one issue. An elder must be able to teach the Word of God. That doesn't mean that an elder has to be the preacher, that an elder has to be the pastor. Doesn't mean they have to be a Sunday school teacher. It simply means they must be able to teach the Word of God. They should be able to express that. To teach someone, an individual doesn't even have to be in a formal situation. They just need to have enough biblical knowledge that when biblical questions come up, they can answer. So we're talking about elders here again with an S. Plural. Never just one. If you read through from the book of Acts to the book of Revelation, you'll find the word elders with an S in plural form about 40 times. About 40 times, depending on which version you're reading. But in my Bible, it was exactly 40. If you read those same books, you'll find the word elder without an S, singular, 3 times. And in all 3 of those cases, the word elder was used by one of the apostles, referring to himself as being an elder, who is an elder among other elders. John said that twice, Peter said it once. So even those cases where we hear the elder without an S, it's an elder referring to himself as one among many elders. So we know elders are referred to in the Bible as plural, more than one within each church. So church leadership is always seen as a group of elders, a group of men who are leading the church. And understand, the word rule there we see in the Bible often really is a leadership. It's influence. We're not talking about a king ruling over a people with a whip and beating people down. We're talking about people that are leading by their influence. Paul says these men who do this are worthy of honor, worthy of double honor in some cases, especially those who preach and teach the Word of God. Just as we learned when we talked about the honoring the widows last Sunday, the word honor means they deserve respect, but also it refers to financial backing, financial support in the cases where they need it. Not every elder gets paid, but some do, especially those who teach and preach the Word of God. Those are especially worthy of double honor. But there's a monetary issue here. Paul expresses that when he quotes the Old Testament. He says in verse 18, the scripture says, he's talking about the Old Testament, you shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain. He's quoting there from Deuteronomy chapter 25, and there God commanded if you're a farmer, Wayne can understand this, if you're a farmer and you've got an animal like an ox that works for you, they used oxen back then to pull things around, and they put them on turnstiles that would tread the grain and do all of that stuff. He says, if you have an ox that's working for you, you as a farmer, you have a responsibility. Feed that animal. Take care of that animal. You can't just work him to death and let him drop. And now Paul's saying, look, the church, you know, if God commanded that an ox that's working be taken care of, it's only right that if an elder is doing good work for the church, that the church support that elder. Why is that the case? Paul says in verse 18, the laborer is worthy of his wages. So the elder that's working hard for the church, and especially those who preach and teach, are worthy of the wages that they receive. They're worthy of that honor. And I want you to understand all of that again. The elders are held accountable by the church. They're not self-accountable. They're not accountable to the other elders. They're accountable to the church as a whole. And the church needs to hold them accountable. Paul says in verse 19, do not receive an accusation against an elder except from 2 or 3 witnesses, those who are sinning, rebuke in the presence of all, that the rest may also fear. So first of all, understand from that elders must be protected by the church. Protected by the church. When you're doing the Lord's work in a church, often people come against you. They don't like something you said. They don't like something that happened in the church. They blame the elder. They blame the preacher. They blame the Sunday school teacher. They blame somebody. And they start inventing accusations to point at that person in the hopes that they'll get them removed from office. Paul says, look, if somebody comes into your church and they're making an accusation against one of the elders, don't listen to them unless they have 2 or 3 witnesses to back up their story. Now that's a biblical pattern. We see that all the way through the Bible, through the Old Testament into the New Testament. Numbers 35 verse 30 says, one witness is not sufficient testimony against a person. And that's pretty obvious. Somebody comes and they say something about somebody, it's not proven unless they have some witnesses to back it up. Deuteronomy says the same thing. Deuteronomy 19 verse 15. One witness shall not rise against a man concerning any iniquity or any sin that he commits. By the mouth of two or three witnesses, the matter shall be established. Now, carry that forward into the New Testament. Jesus said the same thing. Matthew 18, verse 16, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. And now Paul tells us concerning elders in verse 19, do not receive an accusation against an elder except from two or three witnesses. So if someone is going to accuse a leader within the church, there needs to be some witnesses to back up the accusation. Otherwise, you don't listen. Don't listen to that one person that's upset and accusing the pastor, the elders of the church of doing something that they shouldn't be doing. I want you to understand, just because Paul wrote these things doesn't mean that elders within the church, leaders within the church, are beyond accusation. I can tell you, and I'm sure you know, that there are some terrible elders in churches. There are some awful preachers who do some awful things in churches. And Paul says, look, if somebody comes into the church and they accuse the elder, and there's two or three witnesses there that can back up their story, then you need to listen. You need to investigate that, and what if it's true? What if an elder is accused of something by a church member, and there's two or three witnesses, and the church investigates that matter, and has found out that pastor did something, he's caught in some iniquity, some sin, some terrible situation, some disqualifying sin that he's committed? What do you do? What do you do as a church? Paul answers that question in verse 20. He says, those who are sinning, rebuke in the presence of all. Rebuke in the presence of all. If an elder is found to be guilty of committing some disqualifying sin, then we're to rebuke him in front of the whole church. Expose that sin publicly for everybody to know. Now understand, the purpose of this is so that disqualification can be determined. If a pastor is called into accusation and he's found before the church to be guilty of this disqualifying sin, then it's the church's responsibility to remove that elder, that pastor, that overseer from the position of elder. Why is that the case? Well, Paul says that you need to set an example as a church. You need to set an example as a church. Verse 20, he says, those who are sinning rebuke in the presence of all, that the rest also may fear. Now you might be asking the question, well, what if that pastor is repentant? What if he says, I'm sorry for that sin that I committed? And I tell you, that's not the point. That's not the point at all. This happens all the time. A pastor commits some sin. Maybe he's extorted some money from the church. Maybe he's committed a sin with a youth. Hear about that all the time. Pastors abusing children, boys and girls. Maybe he's committed some sexual sin with a church member. And it's found to be true. Comes out and the pastor knows about it. And he comes to some of the other leaders in the church and says, look, I'm really sorry for what I did. And maybe he's doing that simply because he knows that maybe he can keep it a secret. He can keep his sin a secret and maybe they won't expose it the way they're supposed to if he repents, if he says, I'm sorry. And that happens a lot. That happens way more than it should. We hear stories of it happening all the time in the Southern Baptist Convention here lately. These preachers that were caught in these sins and it was reported to the eldership or the leaders within the church and that pastor said, I'm sorry. And what did they do? They just covered it up. They kept it a secret. They allowed that pastor to resign and he went on. And he moved to another church. And what did he do? He committed the same sins that he committed in the one he just left. That doesn't happen when those sins are publicly exposed within the church when they happen. Paul says we do this as an example. When the other elders see that the church is going to hold elders accountable and expose the sins that they've committed, when they see that, they're going to say, hey, I don't want to get caught up in that same mess. I don't want to do what that guy did. I don't want to go through what he's going through. They learn. Proverbs 9, verse 10 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. When you learn the fear of the Lord, When you learn to fear His church, when you learn to fear being exposed, then you're going to say to yourself, I'm not going to do that thing that other guy did because I don't want to have to go through that. They learn. They grow. The other elders, they get knowledge. They get wisdom from that experience of watching the church discipline a member that gets out of line, an elder that gets out of line. They learn fear of the Lord. Paul says in verse 21, I charge you before God and the Lord Jesus Christ and the elect angels that you observe these things without prejudice, doing nothing with partiality. Paul's telling Timothy, this is how you address the church. Church, you are charged before God, before Jesus Christ, before the holy angels in heaven to do these things that are commanded here. You're to show no partiality, no favoritism. It doesn't matter how much you like that man. Doesn't matter how much you love that guy. If he's messing up in church, doing things he ought not to be doing, committing sins that have disqualified him, you've got to rebuke him before the whole church and remove him from the office. There's no option. No choice. No amount of love can cover that up. Got to do it. So what we learn here is that we publicly honor elders who are doing what they're supposed to be doing and doing it the right way. And we publicly rebuke an elder that's not. An elder that's sinning. An elder that's disqualified. Now with all of that said, Paul has one more topic, one more point he wants to make. And that's the selection of elders. How do we choose them? How do we know we're getting the right men? Now we know that he gave us the qualifications back in chapter 3. These are the qualities that you look for in the men. And now he's telling us a little more. He says in verse 22, do not lay hands on anyone hastily. Laying on of hands. We're talking about ordination. Ordination. To lay hands on someone is to affirm them. To say they are qualified. They are gifted. They are prepared to do the work of the position that we're calling them into, whether it be elder or deacon. So we're talking about an ordination process here. Paul says, don't get that in a hurry. Don't get in a hurry when it comes to that. When you have a man that you think is ready to be a leader within the church, don't be too quick to put hands on him and say, we affirm this man. You have to check him out. Examine him. Test him. Question him before you lay hands on him. Paul follows with these words. He says in verse 22, nor share in other people's sins. It's an interesting phrase to me. What does Paul mean there? He's saying, look, whenever you bring a man before the church and you lay hands on him and he's disqualified, you shouldn't be laying hands on him. If you lay your hands on him and you ordain him into church leadership, or if you go back and you don't rebuke those who have been caught in sin, if you don't do those things, then you share in their sins. You share. The King James Version uses the word partaker. You partake of their sins. The Greek word that's translated either share or partaker is the Greek word koinonia. You may have heard it before. It's the word for fellowship. You're taking fellowship. Nobody should ever want to share in, partake of, or have fellowship in somebody else's sin, especially the church as a whole. The Paul said, be very careful about who you lay hands on, because if you lay hands on the wrong man and affirm them, then you're partaking of their sin. Fellowshipping in their sin. But God, we know from Scripture, will chasten, and that means punish. Chasten disqualified church leaders. But also Scripture tells us, especially in the book of Revelation, that Jesus will chasten, God will chasten churches that allow disqualified men to lead. So we have to be very careful about who we lay hands upon. We don't want to partake of their sin, to fellowship with them in their sin. Paul says instead of doing that in verse 22, keep yourself pure. Individually as Christians, we are commanded to remain pure. And as a church, we're called the pure bride of Christ. The church is to remain pure. Now Paul follows that with what I think is kind of an interesting verse. He he goes off track a little bit here. I think he's like a lot of preachers. Sometimes something comes in our head and we kind of get off the track for a moment. We get one verse here where Paul's kind of drifting. And he addresses Timothy specifically. He says in verse 23, no longer drink only water, but use a little wine for your stomach's sake and your frequent infirmities. Kind of like when Paul mentions the word purity, it kind of reminds him that there's a concern that he wanted to address with Timothy. He says, look, hey, Timothy, since we're talking about purity here for a minute, let me offer you a little advice. He says, I know you're up there in Ephesus, and you're drinking only water, and you're doing that because you want to appear to be pure before the church. You don't want your reputation to be accused. You don't want anybody to say, hey, he's a drunkard because he's drinking wine. So I know that's why you're drinking this water. But he says, you got to be careful because that water up there that you're drinking is bad. And the only way that you can drink it is put some wine in it. They didn't understand germs and bacteria and all that stuff back in those days, but they understood that if you put alcohol in water, it would purify it. So they'd add a little bit of wine to the water in order to make the water drinkable. And Paul's telling Timothy, boy, you need to do that because your stomach's sick all the time. Put a little bit of wine in your water. That's not going to rob you of your purity. Purity is really important, but sometimes people abuse it. I know some people that won't take cold medicine, they won't drink NyQuil or anything like that because it's got just that little bit of alcohol in it. They say, I'm not going to do that. It's a sin for me to drink that. It's got alcohol in it. Paul would say, look, you need to drink that stuff because it'll keep you from coughing your brains out. Some people that I know, they won't take a drug. They're in terrible pain. They won't take oxycodone because they say it's a drug. I shouldn't do that. That's a sin. That's not the case. There are times when you do these things for the sake of your health. Paul says that doesn't rob you of your purity. Now, that doesn't mean you can go home after church today and drink a fifth of Jack Daniels and say, hey, here's to my health. That doesn't work. That's a sin. Can't go home after church today and smoke a couple of joints of marijuana and say, man, it makes me feel good. That's a sin. But you can take medicine for medicinal purposes, and that's all Paul's telling Timothy there. Put a little wine in your water because that's going to help keep your stomach from getting sick. Now Paul gets back on the topic. He gets back to verse 24, pulls himself back together. He says, some men's sins are clearly evident. He's talking again about the elders here, preceding them to judgment, but those of some men follow later. Likewise, the good works of some are clearly evident, and those are that are otherwise cannot be hidden. He says, look, there are some people who are clearly qualified to be an elder, and there are some people who are clearly qualified not to be an elder because they committed past sins that they did, obviously, that everybody knows about, and therefore they are disqualified. Now, I've heard people argue. I said, well, that man's forgiven. He's forgiven. He's saved. You shouldn't disqualify him from church leadership because of his past sin, because that's forgiven him. He's saved. And I tell you, this isn't an issue of salvation. Yes, he's saved. Yes, he's forgiven of his sin. But this isn't about salvation. This is about qualification. Just because a man is saved and he's forgiven of past sin, that doesn't mean he's qualified to lead the church. And Paul laid that out specifically for it back in chapter 3. That these sins are evident in a man's life. In his past, he can't be in this leadership position. But we're talking about two different things here. Some people, Paul says, their sins are obvious, they're disqualified. Some people's lives are godly and they are obviously qualified. He says, some people's sins are hidden. They don't show up on the surface. Those are the ones you got to be really careful about. There's some sins who show up in a man later. He says that's why you got to be really careful about laying hands on somebody, about ordaining them, and making sure that the process of ordination can pull that out. Ordination should be a very rigid kind of a process. There should be a time of testing. There should be a time of questioning, a time of examining to make sure that you're laying hands on ordaining the right person. Ordination should never be done as kind of a ceremonial kind of thing, and I think that happens in churches often. I might have told you this story before. I think I did. There was a church a few years back, Southern Baptist Church, a large church up in Brentwood, and they ordained a lady, a woman, an older woman in their church, and they said they did it to honor her for the service that she had done for the church. Now that sounds okay on the surface, but I tell you, it's terrible. Shouldn't happen. If you want to honor somebody for work like that, give them a plaque. Plant a tree out in the churchyard and put their name on it or something, but don't ordain them. To ordain someone is to affirm them in the church leadership. That's what the process of ordination is all about. You ordain, and it should be reserved for the elders, the pastors, the deacons within the church, and it shouldn't go any further than that. If you're not going to call that person in church leadership, don't lay hands on them. Don't ordain them. Paul says you've got to be really careful about that. Make sure you're ordaining the right person and that the kind of ordination that you're going through is going to expose those sins that we've been talking about that might disqualify. He says some men's work is proven to be good. Some men's work is proven to not be good. And then there are some men whose work really won't show up until later. And when that happens, you need to rebuke them and remove them from office. But those pastors, those elders, those who are in church leadership, who are doing a good job, and especially those who work in preaching and teaching doctrine and the Word of God, they're worthy of honor. They're worthy of honor. That's the pattern of church leadership. If any church uses these passages and the passages we learn from chapter 3, and applies them correctly, then that church is going to have good leadership. Going to have good leadership. Again, I tell you, I say this, I'm not in disagreement with the way we run our church. I'm fine with it. Our business model. It works. I think there's a better way. Because I think the scripture lays out a better way. Those are things we need to think about as we move forward as a church. But I think the pattern set for us there. And we need to listen to what Paul has to say. I'm going to close there this morning. We'll move into chapter 6, God willing, next week. Quickly coming to an end of 1 Timothy. Y'all be praying for me about where we're going to go after that. I don't know yet. But we're going to end there this morning, and if you will, let's be turning in our Bible, or hymnals, sorry, to Jerry's favorite song. We're going to try number 330 this morning. Already come to His prayer this morning. Lord, we do thank you for our church leadership. Lord, we have godly men here. And really, as I see it, many of these men that we call deacons are indeed elders. I mean, maybe in our church polity, they might be mislabeled a little bit. Lord, these men, many of them are apt to teach and able to teach the Word of God. They're godly men that lead the church well. But Lord, I don't think we're out of line. Maybe we're just a little miscued here. But Lord, just leads and guides as a church in regard to church leadership. Lord, these men that serve here are good men, and they do the right things, and we don't have any problem with sending elders within the church. Lord, we're grateful that we don't have to go through any kind of discipline process, because right now we're solid, Lord, and I'm convinced of that. Lord, we ask you to, as we grow as a church, and Lord, we pray that you will send new people into our church, and there will come a time when we'll be ready to add some elders, we'll be ready to add some deacons, and when that happens, Lord, let us remember these words. Let's be slow in doing that. Let's be careful in doing it when it comes. Lord, let's be diligent to follow your word, Lord, that we examine them closely and we make sure that they are qualified and gifted and prepared to do the work that that your church requires. Lord, let us not be afraid to discipline when discipline is needed. Let us not be afraid to rebuke an elder that's not doing the job correctly, Lord, that's sinning and disqualified. Let us not be afraid to do as your word calls us to do. Let us not show favoritism or partiality. Lord, just let us be the church that you want us to be, that you demand that we be. Lord, we're this good church, and I think you know that. Lord, let us continue to serve you well, and let us just learn and learn and learn, and let us become more obedient to you every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you all.